first, it was an ideal place,
a place where all things were acting as God desired, acting in conformity with the will of God. But soon, Adam and Eve, who were to be God's representatives on earth, they rejected God's rule by disobeying him, by bringing sin into the human world. They then spoiled or corrupted God's very good creation. He creates it, he pronounces it good, 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 very good. And then Adam and Eve, his representatives, reject his rulership and bring sin into the human world and spoil that very good creation. And as a result, creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. It's no longer a paradise where all things work in conformity with the will of God, that work together and in peace and harmony under God's rule. Instead, our world now is characterized by things like anger and division and hatred and violence and destruction and death and disease and lying and stealing and suffering and sorrow and pain. That's the world you and I live in. And that's how the world is now. And in that sense, it's a creation that is sick as a result of sin. It is a creation that is broken as a result of sin. It has fallen from its original state of glory, which is why Adam's sinning is known in Christian theology as the fall. Creation has been spoiled. Creation has been corrupted. And the story of the Bible, as I hope you've seen, is the story of God's work through the people of Israel, beginning with Abraham in Genesis 12, but through the people of Israel to restore and rescue his creation, which includes mankind. It is his work to rescue creation from its fallen state. People are the high point of God's creation, but his rescue effort includes all of creation, because all of creation was harmed as a result of sin. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 8, 19 to 22, he says that creation itself looks forward to the day when it will be freed from the consequences of human sin. All of creation has been corrupted because of what Adam and Eve introduced into this world. The paradise that was lost in Genesis, so we're looking at the story, the paradise that was lost in Genesis is regained in Revelation. And regained to a transcendent degree. It is regained in an even greater form. This original paradise where everything was functioning under the rulership of God that has been spoiled and corrupted, God works through history. And he's taking creation toward the restoration of his creation. Revelation pictures the restoration of all things promised by God through the prophets. The restoration that Peter mentions in Acts chapter 3, verse 21, pictured in Revelation. The curse that followed sin in Genesis, is removed in Revelation. The curse is removed. And the creation that was defiled by sin in Genesis is transformed into the new heavens and new earth. You see, this is the new heavens and new earth of which Peter spoke. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13, of which Isaiah speaks in Isaiah 65. And is it 66 or 67?
I think 65 and 66. 2 Peter 3:13, but in accordance with his promise, we're awaiting a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. We are waiting for the healing of this sick creation, for the healing of this broken creation, for its renewal, for its transformation, for its restoration. And that is what we're waiting for, and that is our hope. The tree of life, from which mankind was banished in Genesis because of sin. The tree of
eternal home of the redeemed that we see in Revelation. And all of this takes place in association with Christ's return. It's at that time that heaven and earth will merge. And the term I like to use is that creation will be heavenized. That's what's involved, you see. Creation will be heavenized. And probably my favorite text in all the Bible is Revelation 21, verses 1 to 5. It is absolutely breathtaking. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth." What did Peter talk about? What did Isaiah talk about? Well, this is what John is saying. "I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.' Also he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.'" This is take to the bank stuff. This is what I'm doing. I am transforming. I am healing, fixing, restoring the broken creation that all creation has looked forward to. When Jesus comes and tells people the kingdom is at hand, what are they waiting for? And then they're going, "Wait a minute, this kingdom, how are you bringing this kingdom when we don't see this?" And we talked about that. See, in association with his return, that which he inaugurated, which is now coexisting at the consummation, will be the sole reality. All that's contrary to that eternal vision will be stripped out. Now, as I've said numerous times, Jesus is the center of this entire effort. It was decided from eternity that to solve the sin problem that would infect creation, that God the Son, the second person of the Godhead, the Trinity, that God the Son would become the God-man, Jesus Christ, and would take on himself the penalty that all human sin deserve. And this allows God to forgive in a way that is consistent with his character. You see, it allows him to forgive in a way that doesn't make light of sin, that doesn't trivialize sin, that doesn't treat it like rebellion against the perfect and holy Creator. It's no big deal. It allows him to forgive in a way that he can express his love and mercy, and also his holiness and justice. He says, so Jesus is the focal point in the center of this whole effort, and Christ's sacrifice is therefore the key to healing all the consequences of sin. All of the consequences of sin, his sacrifice is the key to healing, even the damage that sin did to non-human creation. That's why Paul says in Colossians 1:19 and 20, he speaks of Jesus as the one through whom God the Father reconciled all things. He reconciled all things to himself, making peace by the blood of his cross. And like Paul says in Ephesians 1:7-10, that God's will for the handling of the end of history, for the administration of that time, for the management of the completion of the ages, is to bring all things together in Christ. Things in the heavens and things on earth. Jesus is the one. He is the reconciler. He is the one who brings all healing, because it is in him that God forgives in a way consistent with his character, and only in him. And so he's the one that brings all reconciliation, all healing. So all the consequences of sin, even those of the non-human creation, are brought to unity and reconciliation in Christ. For all the promises of God find their yes in him. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. Our existence in this redeemed, in this transformed, physical creation. This new heavens and new earth will, as you can imagine, not be as ghosts or as spirit beings. Not at all. It will be as redeemed and transformed people. As physical, resurrected beings. And I really don't have time to do that subject justice, but I feel I have to say something about death and resurrection in light of Gnostic tendencies that exist in Christendom and in the religious world generally that deny or marginalize the physicality of our eternal existence. Let me say something about death, and I'll talk about resurrection. But these things are important to grasp. Now, according to Scripture, physical death, it is the cessation of life in its familiar bodily state. That's what death is. It is the cessation of life in its familiar bodily state. It is not the end of existence. Death is not the end of existence. In other words, life and death are two different states of existence. Dying is a transition from one state to another. We're composed of two elements. I know there's a question about is it two or three. I don't have time to go and explain why I'm convinced it's two. But we're composed of two elements. There's a material component, the body, and an immaterial component, a non-material component, the soul or spirit. And we are body and soul united together. And physical death or loss of life, it involves the separation of soul or spirit from the body. That's what death is. James, I've got a number of texts here. You can see in James 3:26 says, "For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works." Body without the spirit is what? Dead. That's what death is. It is the separation of body and spirit. When the spirit leaves the body, when these two things are decoupled, that's what death is. You see also, you see this in Genesis 2:7. It's implied in 3:19, 35:18. Rachel's soul departing in death. Ecclesiastes 12:7. The spirit returns to God. Matthew 27:50. Jesus gave up his spirit. Luke 8:55. The restoration of Jairus' daughter to life is described as what? Her spirit returning. Death is separation. Restoration to life was the spirit returning. Acts 7:59, Stephen prays for Jesus to receive his spirit as he's dying, being stoned to death. 2 Peter 1:13-14, Peter speaks of dying as putting off his tent. So this is what death is. It's a separation of the non-material, the immaterial component, the soul or spirit, from the body. And death is a conscious existence. It is a conscious existence. Isaiah 14:9-10, it's portrayed that way in these texts. Now, Isaiah, they speak of shades or weak ones who are in the realm of the dead because they're a shadow or a reflection of the full-bodied existence they are on earth. But you still see their conscience. You see it there in Isaiah 14:9-10, Ezekiel 32. You see it in Luke 16:19-31, the parable of the rich man and Lazarus, right? In death, they are conscious. So you see that? You see it there? You see it in Revelation chapter 6, verse 9-11, where you have the souls. What are they? They're under, I just have 9 and 10 here. They're under the altar, but they're conscious. And so death is a separation of body from spirit, but it is a conscious existence. You can also see in Luke 24:23, where Jesus tells the thief or the rebel that he would be with him in paradise. You see, paradise carries a connotation of pleasantness that would be inapplicable to an unconscious state. Right? I mean, would you see what you say? If anybody is unconscious, well, you're going to be with me in paradise. You won't know it. So you see, it has those connotations. So death is a conscious existence, and there's a distinction in the conditions of the existence of dead people in the state distinction between the post-death conditions of the righteous and the wicked. There is a distinction there. The ungodly rich man, where is he? He's in misery. The ungodly rich man is in misery. The godly poor man is in a state of blessing and comfort. And you see that that distinction is clearly fixed. You see verse 26 says there's a great chasm that separates the two in these distinctive states, so there's no crossing over. Luke 23, verse 43, Jesus refers to the blessed post-death state of the righteous. As I just said, he calls that one paradise. You see, something really pleasant, really good. He told that penitent thief that he would be with him in paradise on that day. So death for the righteous, death for the Christian, is not to be viewed as an unpleasant prospect. It's not to be viewed as something to be dreaded or feared. On the contrary, when you look here, Revelation 14, 13, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Philippians 1, 21, Paul says that to him to live is Christ, and what? To die is gain. And that his desires to depart be what? For this is far better. His desires to depart be with Christ, why? Because this is far better. And Paul understands it was work for him to do. But he's just saying, look, this is far better. 2 Corinthians 5, 6, and 8. Therefore, having confidence always and knowing that while being at home in the body, we're away from the Lord, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We have confidence, forget the faith, I say, and would prefer rather to be away from the body and be at home with the Lord. This would be a wonderful, pleasant, joyful, blessed thing. Hebrews 2, 15, Christ's death was intended to free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. So you see this for the righteous, for the Christian, that this conscious existence after death is a glorious and wonderful thing. You see, it's something that's not to be dreaded. You see, as I say, I don't want to suffer when I die. I'm a chicken. But I know what through that door. But it's a glorious and a wonderful thing. You see, as the Christian's death, his or her spirit goes to be with Christ. See, the spirit goes to be with Christ in heaven. Those texts that Paul says in the text that I just mentioned, he speaks of death as departing and being with Christ. Well, that sounds grand, doesn't it? Departing and being with Christ, being at home with the Lord in Acts 7, 56 to 59. Stephen says he saw heaven open. He's being stoned. He saw heaven open and he sees the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. And then while he's being stoned to death, he prayed to the Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. As I mentioned to you, that text in Revelation 6, the souls of the martyrs, they're pictured there in heaven in that existence. Now they're shown there symbolically. They're under the altar. But you have them, where are they? They're in heaven. And so when Paul says, look, this would be great, this would be better by far, my dying, the separation of my soul and spirit from my body, and it going to be with Christ would be grand. I realize there are things I need to be doing here. And so I'm going to hang on here. The Lord's going to keep me here. But you see how glorious that is. Now, life after death. Life as a spirit in heaven with the Lord will be far better than life in this world. But that's not the end for the Christian. Now, I get tired of saying this, but we continue to talk this way. That is not the end of the story. Our resurrection, but that's what death no longer has mastery over. Death is no longer subject to death. Why? Because he's been resurrected, not resuscitated, resurrected, so that he's no longer subject to death. He is now what? Immortal physically. He is immortal. He has the body of which Paul speaks in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. See, his resurrection serves as a pledge, the first fruits, it's a pledge on God's part of the final end time harvest. So here he comes, the harvest begins, we share in this, and there's going to be this end time harvest. And our resurrection is so much tied to his that in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 14, Paul says, we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus. He's going to raise us with Jesus. Well, that's the first fruit. It's a harvest. We're going to be raised as part of that harvest. He will raise us with Jesus. We're all the same harvest. Jesus is called what? The firstborn from the dead. He's the firstborn from the dead. Well, who's going to follow him? Who's going to follow me in his resurrection? There you go. You see, he's the firstborn. And we, as part of the Lord's resurrection harvest, we as Christ then was raised immortal, having been raised from the dead so as to be no longer subject to death. In other words, he's immortal, right? He's no longer subject to death. He was subject to death. How do you know he died? But when he was resurrected in a transformed way so that he's no longer subject to death. He is immortal. And see, and we as part of that resurrection, we will likewise receive live forever in resurrected bodies. See, until Christ returns, dead people exist as conscious, bodiless spirits in a place of blessing or suffering, depending on their relationship with God at the time of their death. That's where we are now. Now, at Christ's return, they'll be resurrected, meaning the disembodied spirit will be united with a transformed body that will go on forever, that's suited for eternal existence, which is what Paul means, by the way, when he says spiritual bodies. People take that and they go, he doesn't say spirits. He says spiritual bodies. And he doesn't contrast physical and spiritual. He contrasts natural and spiritual. So what he's saying is they're going to be raised spiritual bodies, meaning supernatural bodies that are suited for the eternal age. So this is what, so there's going to be this resurrection where you're going to have these disembodied spirits united with a transformed body that's suited for eternal existence. What Paul describes in 1 Corinthians 15 as immortal and imperishable bodies. And then they will be assigned their permanent dwelling place based on their relationship with God. God's children will spend eternity in the love and joy, the perfect fellowship of the new heavens and new earth. That's why I say on that day, I've said so many times, I will be hugging you. You may not want it. But see, we'll be hugging each other and rejoicing and saying, do you remember when we sat around in a little place in my house? We sat around here in Mesa? And I don't just mean, see, I mean literally hugging each other in resurrection bodies. See, this is what, this is the hope. And it's going to be a new heaven and new earth. It's going to be the perfect place. It's the divine utopia. That's why that text in Revelation 21 where he says, there'll be no more mourning or crying or suffering and pain. The old order of things has passed away. This is where we will live. There will be nothing but pure and complete love with one another. Pure and complete fellowship with God. And we will live forever in that reality. You see, there's no hope like that. That's the greatest. That's the greatest. And that's the hope that we have as Christians. Now, so we have that. Now, I've had it in my life. I've taught about this, and I've had a number of eye-opening experiences. When I taught about one time many years ago now, I was teaching, I probably told you this, I was teaching at the White Station Church of Christ in Memphis, Tennessee. This would have been in the, probably 87, maybe 96, 85, 86, sometime around there. And I was teaching the young people. They let me do that then. And I was teaching the young people, and I said, I was talking about this. And I get all these looks, they were dumb. These kids had grown up in the Church of Christ, they never heard I should say John's face. His granddaughter just discovered that he had a very large nose yesterday. I said, "Where's she been, man? You got to take her to an optometrist or something." And she just noticed that. But she did say something good yesterday. So yeah, the next one I want to read is it's a three-slide book. This is from N.T. Wright. Now, for what it's worth, N.T. Wright is probably the best-known theologian in the world today. Now, Wright says, he writes on the early church, but his production is insane. When you see the volumes that this guy's put out, the quality and the depth of work, doesn't mean you have to agree with everything. I understand. I'm just saying this guy is quite a producer and then somebody who knows early Christianity and thinking. All right. He says, mention salvation, and almost all Western Christians assume that you mean going to heaven when you die. But a moment's thought in the light of all we've said so far reveals that this simply cannot be right. Salvation means, of course, rescue. But what are we ultimately to be rescued from? The obvious answer is death. But if when we die, all that happens is that our bodies decompose, while our souls, or whatever other word you want to use for our continuing existence, go on elsewhere, this doesn't mean we've been rescued from death. It simply means we've died. That's what death is. It's the separation of the spirit from the body. He says that if God's good creation, you remember good, 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 very good? And if God's good creation of the world, of life as we know it, of our glorious and remarkable bodies, brains, and bloodstreams really is good, and if God wants to reaffirm that goodness in a wonderful act of new creation at the last, then to see the death of the body and the escape of the soul as salvation is not simply slightly off course, in need of a few subtle alterations and modifications. It is totally and utterly wrong. It is colluding with death. It is conniving at death's destruction of God's good, image-bearing human creatures while consoling ourselves with the essentially non-Christian and non-Jewish thought that the really important bit of ourselves is saved from this wicked, nasty body in the sad, dark world of space, time, and matter. Do you see the Gnosticism in it? This was the Gnostic view. You see that really, creation itself is like this dark, fallen, bad thing from the hand of God. And that the only way to really be spiritual and be right on is to escape from the material world. You see, to escape, and in that way you can have this kind of thing. Last section on this, he says, as we have seen, the whole of the Bible, from Genesis, this is the story, from Genesis to Revelation, speaks out against such nonsense. It is, however, what most Western Christians, including most Bible Christians of whatever sort, actually believe. But I hope that's not true of many of you. What they actually believe, he says, this is a serious state of affairs reinforced not only in popular teaching, but also in liturgies, public prayers, hymns, and homilies every time. You see this stuff in our songs. Right? I can pull out some of the songs. So when I'm thinking of mine, I've got to go, okay, this is the intermediate state. This is the intermediate state. But that's where they leave it. And as I say, great, glorious, wonderful to be at home with the Lord. There's no question about that. Freed from the fear of death. Have a wonderful existence. But that's not the end. The end is you and I in resurrection bodies living eternally in the divine utopia, this place of perfect harmony, perfect fellowship, where all of the tragedies and things that we see today, the backbiting, all this kind of stuff, this backstabbing, the lack of love, the selfishness, the hatred, the anger, the murder, the suffering, the disease, all that when you open the You open a newspaper today, break your heart. Or actually, when you click on the newspaper. But just break your heart. This guy's molesting these kids. These people are doing this. They're killing people by the truckload. Killing 43 students down in Mexico. Doing this and that. And this is the so-called. You see, and the idea that we're going to live along for eternity in this broken world is contrary to the system.